I'm here to introduce a good friend of mine. I've known Kamal for about 5 years, and I don't know how many of you have heard Kamal speak, many of you probably before. Anybody have not heard Kamal speak? Well, you're in for a treat, so if you haven't eaten, you're going to get a pretty good meal right here. He has a lot of knowledge. You're going to hear about his story, but just from me firsthand, I can tell you I've had some turmoil in our family during this time, and Kamal has been like a true brother, praying and helping, and I can tell you firsthand, he's the real deal. And I count him not just as a brother in Christ, or a friend rather, but as a brother in Christ. And I'm going to ask you to give as warm a welcome as you can, a West Michigan welcome for Kamal Saleem.
So, if we celebrate anything tonight, we celebrate the glory of the living God, the one who made this place for us tonight, that we can stand in bravery and liberty for this nation. My name is Kamal Saleem. Before I talk about anything, I want to talk about our series that we just put out there. If you don't know what's happening in this nation, you need to get this series. It's called Unveiling. It's a 12 study. The ugly truth and the beautiful truth. What's happened in our nation, verbatim, it's made for our teachers, leaders, military, for our home schoolers, for missionary. This will help you tremendously. And this will give you the strategy and how to pray, how to stand, and how to be involved. This is me and General Jerry Boykin, and here me and different people that just put it together. Would you give this one to somebody as a gift? One of each. Don't give them two. They'll get spoiled. Just give them half.
Very good. Very
good. Thank you, my brother. Well, I want to tell my favorite joke, and it's very important to me that we understand who we are in Christ. So Moses was walking in the desert, and his people says, "Moses, we need water. We have not drank water for ages. Can you get us some water?" He said, "Let me talk to God." And he talked to God for a little bit, and he said, "Well, Moses, the staff that you're in your hand, strike that rock, and I will give you water." He said, "Prophesy, speak it out, declare it." So he did, and water came out. And Moses looked at this and he said, "There's plenty of water. I haven't bathed for a long time. I should do it before anybody else comes about." So he took his clothes off and put them on a rock. And now this story was happening, was happening in the UN, United Nations. And this is the Israeli ambassador to the UN was telling that story. And as he was telling the story, he said he put his clothes on a rock and then he went to bathe. And as he came out of the water, his clothes were stolen. And he looked and he saw a Palestinian man stole his clothes and run away. And everybody started going, "Boo, boo, boo. There was no Palestinian. There was no Palestinian." He said, "This is my point exactly." Tonight, even though I'm going to be speaking on unveiling, on the truth and whatsoever, what's happened in our nation, but I want to tell you, America is beautiful, and America is still beautiful. It is one of the most beautiful nations on earth. I travel the world and the fullness of it. Even at its finest hour, there is nothing like America. America is heaven on earth, and today you are privileged to be in this nation because you are Americans. In the Word of God, in Ezekiel 33 and 1-6, the Word of God says, "The Lord came to him and the Son of Man. He said, 'Speak to your countrymen and let them know when I bring the sword against the land, and the people of the land choose one of their men to make him watchman on a wall. And he sees the sword coming against the land, blow the trumpet and warn the people. Then if anyone hears the trumpet but does not take warning, then the sword would come against him and his blood on his head. But if the watchman does not warn the nation, warn the people, then the blood of people on his head.'" Tonight I stand before you to let you know what's happening in our nation. Our nation is not asking for your prayers only. Our nation needs an action. In the last 2 years, you know, last terms of election, the church, only 6% of the church voted. This is disgrace. And we could not allow that to happen. And when I came to the United States of America, what I found something special about America, and like any other nation, in Islam, when you're born to Islam, you are Muslim. But in Christianity, when you're born to Christianity, you are not Christian until you receive Jesus Christ. And your citizen today is not active unless you walk in it and make it happen. Our citizenship is crying out for us to arise in last days. When a church loses its character, it loses its identity. And when identity lost, then it loses its integrity. It becomes worldly and has no value and fruitless. It becomes insignificant. One time I heard a story that this airplane was going through heavy turbulence, and the people start screaming, and they were filled with fear. And the captain came on a loudspeaker and he said, "Do not fear, don't be afraid. This airplane integrity, it is strong and it's powerful. It will take us to our destiny, wherever we go into." We need to understand today where you stand with Christ. Your integrity is in Him, and He can take you to that place. We could not lose our integrity in such time as this. Now, the King of Europe made themselves the head of the church. And when they made the head themselves, because they were hungry for power. And now they were controlling everybody. The Christian believers migrated to the United States of America to establish new kingdom. They came to the United States of America running from tyranny. And they trusted in God. The word of the book of Psalms 54 and 4, it says, "Surely God is my helper. The Lord is the one who sustains me." America must understand that its power, it is not its itself or its government or leadership or politicians. Its power, it's in the church, in the power of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. In God we trust. What prompted the original colonists to embrace the idea that the land of America was the new Jerusalem to them? What power urged General George Washington and his ragtag army to successfully conquer the greatest military on earth, the UK, England? They trusted in God. In the book of Hebrews 13 and 6, he said, "So he said to me, say with confidence, the Lord is my helper." America trusted in God, and the people came to America to be dependent on God. Christopher Columbus asserted he was guided by angels when he lost his way and when life was dark over there and he didn't know what to do. He called on God, and angels came, they were dispensed to his help. And Apostle Paul, he said, "The ministry of angels is one of the biggest ministry today. We could not walk without our angels. The fervent, effectual prayer of the righteous man availeth much." Why do we need to pray? When we pray, God will move. What is the secret behind a nation unsurpassed record of prosperity, protection, and liberty? They trusted in God. In Psalms 33:12, it says, "Blessed is a nation whose God is the Lord, the people He's chosen for His inheritance." Are you His inheritance? Okay, three people said yes. Are you His inheritance? Yes. Amen. That's what makes us special. What is the responsibility and consequence incumbent, mandatory upon the people so blessed? Our forefather chose liberty for us. Our forefather, when they were creating the Constitution of the United States of America, they looked all over the world and they could not find anything. Then they looked to the Word of God, to the Bible. They looked into the book of Isaiah, and God gave them every level of the government. So God created a government, a constitution for you to hold in such a time as this, led by the church, birthed out of the church. The church is the ecclesia for God. What is the ecclesia? The parliament on earth. We are His people, ambassadors of God, and we speak about His kingdom in such time as this. They turned to God and the God of the Bible. Our liberty and justice for all. This is what our forefather chose for us. Today, when we pledge the allegiance to the American flag, we always say with liberty and justice for all. What is liberty and what is justice for all? What is the land of the free and the home of the brave? The freedom did not come about until they bought the freedom with their blood. They died for what they believe, and they took stand, and when they understood what freedom was, they became the land of the free. And what made them brave is because they conquered their fear, and they conquered their enemy, and they conquered tyranny. And when somebody oppressed them, they said to him, hit the road, Jack, and don't come back no more. Today we have a lot of Jacks up there, and somebody need to sing the song for them. Genesis 49, America is under Abrahamic covenant. The covenant was given to Father Abraham and to God himself. He says, I am the God of Father Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. But today, that covenant is fulfilled to us in Christ Jesus. He is the spiritual covenant that has fulfilled everything. He became the way and the life and the truth. And today we become a gateways for the nation. He said, my house shall be called house of prayers for all nations. Is that right? Absolutely. I came to destroy this nation. I came to destroy her. The way I came to destroy her is not what the 9/11 people did. I came to take her children and change her future. And it was very good. But there's a God that's watching for this nation. And he's standing on your wall day and night, and he's saying, not on my shift. Even when America slept, God did not. And God conquered me for this nation. So today, I stand conquered before you. Jesus Christ came, he said, he humbled himself, he came. And I understand humility. Humility is the victory that Jesus walked with the cross on his back. And today we celebrate a victorious God who conquered hell, sin, and death. And we could not step down from the path that he put for us. During the English invasion, the royal family said, the problem with America is the church. The church stood against the English army. And when the pastors became the leaders, when the pastors became the Black Robe Regiment, when the pastors led the war, when the pastor said for God and for country, when the pastor said to live is Christ and to die is gain, the enemy were filled with shame and fear and run away. Where are you pastors today? What stand are you taking for your nation? The book of Ezekiel, he said, woe unto you, those who turn my sheep to the wolves. Today, we need to remember who we are, and we need to take a stand, and that stand for God and for his glory. Yeah. Liberty was choice. Liberty is still choice. You can live in shame, or you can live in fame. Your choice today is which direction you want to go. 1 Corinthians 10, 11 and 12, he said, this is a warning. There is a generation declaring that they are wise, but they are fools. That's what the Word of God says. These things happen to them as an example. It's happening to us. They're written down to warn us about this. So he said, be careful. When you think you are standing firm, you might fall. Where do you stand today? Have you examined yourself? When diversity, tolerance, appeasement, and coexistence become the new war against our Constitution and our godly belief, this is when we know we are at war. The enemy's at war with us, and they don't want us only. They want everything we have. Why? Because they do not believe in God. We saw them at the DNC when they said, shall we bring God? They said, no, we don't want God. Do you remember that? Those who remember, put your hand up. They don't want God within government. Ephesians 6 and 12, the Word of God says, we do not fight against flesh and blood. Today our war is against Satan and his dominion and those who are serving him. But our job is not over, because many of these people that blinded out there, the Word of God says, the God of this world has blinded them, lest the gospel of good news reach them. You are the gospel of the good news. God put His Word in you, and now you are salt and light for the last days. On January 21st, 1776, in Virginia, Pastor John Peter Muhlenberg spoke on his pulpit. And he said, "For everything there is a reason. For everything there is a season, for every time and matter under heaven." And he stood before them, he said to his congregation, "This time I'm shedding the patriot blood. Brethren, this is no longer time for peace, it's now time for war. Standing before you for the last time is your shepherd, pastor, and a servant." John Peter Muhlenberg took his minister black robe off and he revealed his military uniform. He said, "Now stand before you, Colonel John Peter Muhlenberg, honored to serve the Continental Army under the Commander-in-Chief, General George Washington. Who is willing to join me? You, mister, you, sir, would you join me?" The whole church joined him. They were not afraid. They know what bravery is, and they know what the value is, even that it's cost them their blood. But they know that their children will live in freedom. And he went on, he said, "Will the future generation maintain the independence and treasure our legacy? Yes, if they keenly be aware, past sacrifices and relentlessly demand virtue, integrity, and honor and truth. From whom? From their self first. And then from whom? From their leaders." What kind of condition are we in? What kind of accountability are we putting our leaders under? Who are you voting for? When you're voting, when you're not voting, you are voting. When you're not speaking, you are speaking. When you're not marching, you are marching. When you're becoming quiet, you are declaring you're lost. It's a time. He said, if this season come when the leaders say one thing and do another, just like right now, when deception become the center of everything, when the collective voice of the people is ignored, when self-ambition overshadow the common good, when religion and morality are ignored as only foundation of sound government. He said, pastors, leaders, and may the intercessors, the pastor and leader, ask for individual national repentance, to arise and repent, and to march, and to take stand. This is what they stood for. Today, we live in a victory that they offered us, and that victory was bought by blood. Freedom is not for free. Abraham Lincoln talked about our liberty. He said, "We are here highly resolved, these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth, freedom, and that the government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth." Jesus Christ says in Mark 12:7, he said, "And render to Caesar what is Caesar's, and render to God what is God's." Our Constitution today is our Caesar. What it dictated for us in Article 6, that this is the law of the land. But when we have a president standing and he said, "We made a progress, and we could finish for more progress, but what stands before us and progress is the American Constitution," 3 weeks ago in Washington, D.C. Today, America is under invasion, and the church are the enemy of the United States, number one. This is you. What is the American exceptionalism? In the summer of 1787, Benjamin Franklin was walking down the street, and a woman stopped him and asked him, "What kind of government have you given us?" He said, "A republic, madam, if you can keep it." What he's saying to us, we are going to have to fight for it. And he's speaking to us, a republic, but we have to take a stand for it. We have to make the difference. And he is saying, "We have given it to you. In this document, we fought for it, and we shed blood for it. But what are you going to do about it today? It's your call. Yesterday, we were the grandchildren, but today, we are the grandfathers, and our grandchildren are waiting for us to see what we're going to do. For me and my house, declared Joshua, we worship the Lord. And the Saleems, for me and my house, we will worship the Lord. It is time for America to arise. It is time for America to say, let God arise, and let his enemy be scattered, and let the righteous be glad. It is not about color. It is not about ethnicity. It is not about background. It's in Christ and Christ alone. And that's what America we know. The question today, do you believe in this America? America is still to this day the most giving people in the world in charity. 98% of the world giving finances come from the United States of America. The American cradle of the gospel is here. It's the cradle of the gospel all over the world. America is number one sending missionary worldwide. America is the bread basket for the world. God has blessed our field, and he's given us rain, and he's given us plenty, despite the curses that the enemy put upon this land. America has the greatest military record in the world. It's the born again nation. When all nations were declared, God brought America. Hope for the hopeless, strength for the weak. Those who didn't have home, they found liberty. They run away from tyranny. They came home and they became American. What makes us special today, if you want to live in our nation, we welcome you to live under our constitution and to abide by our law. You could be a Muslim, you could be Chintu, you could be Satanist. But we expect you to live as an American citizen and abide in our laws. That is the America we know. God is a God of grandstand. In the days of Ezekiel, when the army gathered from everywhere, God rose for him. He said, mighty man of valor, rise. Gideon, he didn't know what to do, how to fight. He said, arise. All God wants us to do is to take stand. And when we take stand, he will send angels charge over us, Psalms declare. The word of God is a promise. His word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Today I stand on the word of God because it's absolute. And today, if you have no other place to go to, run to God. Run to Jesus. Amen. The American flag means a lot to me. When I see it, I see the writing on the wall with blood. The blood of the brave. Saying, we fought for you, we kept the promise, and we kept you free. That's what I hear. We are the grandchildren today, at that day, but now our grandchildren are crying for us. From the shores of Normandy to the heights of Europe, on every place, America fought. Let me tell you something about your history. In World War II, American soldiers freed one continent. In World War II, they freed two continents. In the Civil War, nearly 500,000 American men shed their life to set the slave free. They died for the slave because they believe in freedom. In World War I, 116,500 died. In World War II, and this is to set Europe free, in World War II, 400,000 American soldiers gave their life to set humanity free. In the War of Korea, 36,374. In Vietnam, 58,000. In Kuwait, 2,500. In Iran, 128. In Iraq, 4,734. In Afghanistan, 2,232. They fought for the Muslims. They fought for the Hindus, for the Chintus. They fought for everybody. It was not about what your background is, but because they believe in liberty. They believed in freedom because our Constitution declared it. And that's the word of God that lives in us. If God is for us, who can stand against us? I want to talk about something very special tonight. How are we doing on time? Good. This man, his name is Saul David Alinsky. Anyone know who is Saul David Alinsky? Okay, put your hand up. I want to see it. Keep it up, please. Wow, praise God. Those who do not know who Saul David Alinsky, put your hand up, please. It's almost 50%. I want to talk about this man, and I'm going to show what he's done for us as a nation. He's educated in University of Chicago, and he graduated there with criminology. He was an American community organizer and a writer. He's generally considered the founder of modern community organization. He was called the grandfather of community organizers. He is often noted in his books as the Rules of Radicals. His occupation was community organizer, writer, and political activist, known for political activism and community organization. Notable work rivaled for Radicals, and the second one, that's his first book, his second book, Rules for Radicals. He was an American community organizer, writer. He's generally considered to be a founder of modern community organizer, and his job was to socialize United States of America. He wanted to create a social nation and change America from its democracy and every power that it has. He's often noted in his book, Rules of Radicals, How to Create Social State by Saul Alinsky. There are 8 levels of control that must be obtained before you are able to create social state. The first and the most important one, he said in his book, healthcare. Control healthcare, he said, and you will control the people. The second one, poverty. Increase the poverty level as high as possible. Poor people are easier to control and will fight back if you are providing everything for them. Obama's money. Debt. Increase the debt to an unsustainable level. That way you are able to increase tax, and this will produce more poverty. Are you listening to me? Number 4, gun control. Remove the ability to defend self from government. If you remove the guns, then they will have no self-defense. That way you are able to create a police state. Number 5, warfare. Take control of every aspect of their life, food, housing, and income. They will become your slave. Education. Take control of what people read and listen to. Take control of the children learn in the school. Michelle Obama stood 5 weeks ago in D.C. upon graduation of 5,000 high schoolers. And she said to them, where we're going today is a different way. We have a modern strategy, and we are cusp of change of time. If your elder tell you otherwise, report them to the government, because we are the new revolution. Religion. Remove the belief in God from the government and school, and the school children will surrender to the ungodly. Class warfare. Divide the people into wealthy and poor. This causes more discontent, and it will be easier to take tax from the wealthy with the support of the poor. Are you listening to me? Does that sound familiar? Saul Alinsky was called the father of community organizer. And what does that mean to us? When we start studying his book and start looking at it, we found the definition in his book, community organization is the political practice of organizing communities to act in their own common self-interest. Now, Saul Alinsky's son, David Alinsky, he said, Obama has mastered everything his father has said verbatim. And he was able to practice this rule to the point that he is probably better than his father. In a letter to the editor of Boston Globe, he published in August 31, 2008, he said, Barack training in Chicago by the great community organization is showing its effectiveness. It's amazingly powerful format and method of the late father always worked to get messages out and get the supporters on board. Are you listening to me? When executed methodically, you know, and thoughtfully, it's powerful strategy for initiating change and making it really happen. Obama learned his lesson. I'm proud to see that my father's model for organization is being applied successfully beyond local community organizing to affect the Democratic campaign. This is what has happened. And now we are, our government, even though that they say they're Christian, they are not Christians. Before President Obama was elected as a president, the King of Saudi Arabia was on TV being interviewed, and he said word for word, he said, the next president of the United States of America will be a Muslim man. 4 years before he was elected. There are six rules that explain Obama words and deeds. Number one, it is the politics is all about power relation, but to advance one's power, one must coach one's position in the language of morality. Are you listening to me? The second one, there's only three kind of people in the world, rich and powerful, oppressors and poor, and disenfranchised, oppressed, and middle class whose apathy maintained the status quo. He formed what they are, and he know what they are, and he know how to play them. Number three, he said, change is brought about through relentless agitation and troublemaking of a kind that radically disturb the society. So by agitating the society, he will create the issues and he will arise to accomplish what he needed to accomplish. Number four, he said, there can be no conversation between the organizer and his opponent. The latter must be depicted as being evil. So you make your enemy evil look out there as bad guys. Number five, the organizer can never focus on just single issue. He must move inexhaustibly from one issue to another to create multitude of issues that the people could not catch up with it. These in the book. Number six, taunt one's opponent to the point that they label you as dangerous enemy of the establishment. Just last week, Obama stood and he said, I'm not running for president again, but he said, let it rip. Affordable Act, let it rip. Benghazi, Libya, let it rip. IRS, let it rip. Dream Act, let it rip. I have a pen and a phone, let it rip. How much more do you need? The church is losing its ground, and now next things will be hiding underground. What if a nuclear bomb goes on one coast? What if 3,000 terrorists bomb themselves over the United States of America? Then what would happen next? Martial law will be the center of this nation. And guess what? We're stuck where we're at today. You see, the Affordable Act or the Dream Act, today the problem is we don't have the problem only with the people who are coming from South America. But the problem is there are millions of radical Muslims coming through the Mexican borders. Today, there are several million of those that are here in the United States of America ready to have the citizenship. This is what's taking place in our nation. Why do I talk about this? Because somebody got to talk about it. In Al-Hawar Center Dialogue in Washington, D.C., they just revealed that Obama was in... He studied the Muslim Brotherhood and he was in coalition with them right from the beginning of his election. Hand in hand, he was working with the Muslim Brotherhood. He knew about Benghazi before it happened. He met with their radical leaders and he invited them and they spoke in D.C. right here, right in our nation. And they were not in power because Gaddafi destroyed them. What happened? He brought them in power and he put them in power today. So when we look what happened in Libya, we go, what happened? Did our government knew about this ahead of time? Listen, the world still fear and respect and revere America, but the world has no respect for Obama. Today, the Muslim Brotherhood penetrated the seven mountain of influence. They are within our nation on every wall, that even if he's no longer a president, they are in power and staying there to change our nation. How much time do I have? No, sir, I gotta respect time. Let me take you somewhere very special here. I'm gonna reveal the five strategy of Islam, how they're going to destroy this nation. Strategy number one, face the discreet secret establishment of leadership within our leadership. Phase number two, it has five phases. The first phase, number one, has already been accomplished. The second one, number one, is the gradual appearance in public scene and exercising, utilizing various public activities. They have accomplished that. It's also succeeded in a great deal infiltrating various sectors of the government. They have changed our government. Now, terrorism in the United States of America is no longer terrorism. Terrorists are no longer, terrorists are our friends. Unless you kill somebody, then you are a terrorist. The hate crime bill that's just been signed, it was signed against the Christian and the conservative movement in the United States of America. If you speak against anybody else, we're going to throw you in jail. And it was an executive bill. It was not a constitution bill. Gain and religious institute, and they have been turning this nation against us. Kansas, the mayor invited me to speak over there for the city. The Muslim Brotherhood withstood me. And what happened? God, people start, you know, sending email to the mayor, and the mayor asked me to come in. And what happened? The Muslim Brotherhood, to stop him from bringing me again or anybody like me, they went and penetrated his church. One man came to the church to his pastor, and he said, I have no place to worship. And as he walked to the church, what happened then? He brought his family. They gave him place to worship. Now he's practicing Islam in the church on Friday, declaring Allahu Akbar. God of Islam is the one. And so what happened is, when he brought now the movement growing up to 7,000 people in the church, that pastor, that mayor could not invite anyone because you're offending the Muslims. Are you listening to me? We are being shamed in our home. Embracing senior scholars, and it's happening. Gaining public supporters and sympathy. Crying to the public, look what America is doing to us. Look what these people are doing to us. Stop them. Establishing shadow government secret within the United States government. And they have established that on a severe sphere of influence. Phase number three, now it's being escalated and it's taking place. And it's prior to the conflict and confrontation with the rulers through utilizing mass media currently in progress. They have bought every media in the United States of America, including Fox News. You don't hear Fox talking about Islam, except Hannity. Phase number four, open public confrontation with the government and through exercising political pressure approach, it's aggressively implementing the above-mentioned approach and then training with the use of weapons domestically and overseas. We have 36 assault Islamic camps in the United States of America by a radical movement, Al-Shabaab, from Pakistan. But how they're using this? They use our law against us and they terrorize us by our laws. Phase number 5, seizing the power to establish Islamic nation under the party of Islamic group, and they are united. This is what we come into. Our America needs us more than ever. America is sick. And if I know who is the power in the United States of America, is God people. The word of God says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, if they seek my face and return from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven. Then we will hear the land. This is the promise of God. It is time for the intercessor to take a stand and cry, holy, holy, holy. It is time to make the way and the life and the truth before the living God. It is time to declare that we are Christians. It is time to say we are not ashamed. You can shame us all you want, but we will not relent. We will take a stand. It is the time for the sons and daughters of this nation to take a stand, just where I'm standing today. This country is calling her sons, come back home. The word of God says, the fervent, effectual prayer of the righteous man availeth much. Your voice is the voice of power. It activates the throne of God. He said, call upon me and I will answer you. I will show you great and mighty things you do not know. It is time to say, Daddy, Father, come and rescue us. America, finest hour is upon us. America is not gone. America is still powerful in God. Listen, Europe is falling. A lot of things happening. Many things happening. Today, there are nations within nations. In UK, there are over 50 states, Islamic state. At night, there are Muslim state. The government would not go in there. They declare Sharia, and now they don't want the English laws anymore. They want Islamic law in England. With ISIS, there are thousands coming from United States of America, Europe, all over. They are fighting for Islam. And when they're being interviewed, they said, next time we'll come to Western civilization, we will have La ilaha illallah wa Muhammad Rasulullah. We'll have the flag of there's no God but Allah and Muhammad, his prophet. This is what we're facing today. We could not turn blind eyes on this. We could not change our feather from an eagle to an ostrich. We could not hide our head in the sand. My friend General Jerry Boykin, he's a founding member of Delta Force. He was the commander in Mogadishu, Somalia, during Black Hawk Down, if you remember that. Do you remember that? At the end of the battle, there were black bags in front of him all over. And he was crying. He was travailing. He said, why, God? Why? Why, God? And he was looking at them and he was asking the question, did I do everything within my power to save your life? He was asking them one by one, have I done everything to save your life? Today we gotta ask ourselves, have we done everything to save our children and grandchildren, our American Constitution, our very special America life? Have we thought about this? Have we tried it yet? Where do you go from here today is a choice. Bravery and shame are choice. If you are brave, you will take a stand for your family and your loved one, because this nation worth dying for. For me, I already made my place, and tomorrow we'll move again. We move 2-3 times every year. Why? Because they love us to death, but we don't let them. But today, there's many of you, and if you take a stand, we can change the world. Not America, the world. May God bless you. And may God bless the United States of America. To God be the glory. Everybody, to God be the glory. 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 Listen, the German, not all of them were Nazis. The German, many of them were good. But when they shut up and they didn't do anything, the whole nation was taken away from them. Their home, their children, their jobs, their life. What's happening in the Middle East right now with ISIS, World War III has already started and launched. Where do we take stand today? We can change the world by praying and by taking stand. Thank you so much.